sponsored by Surfshark VPN. We have two problems. One, the digital age has an insatiable appetite for energy, and more massive data centers are being built every single year. And two, we need an incredible amount of energy to heat our homes, office buildings, and water. As good as renewable energy sources like solar and wind are, the answer can't just be add more power generation. What if we could kill two birds with one stone? Like using the waste heat generated by all those computers to heat our homes, office buildings, and water. And what if you could get that heat essentially for free? That's what one company is trying to do. Let's explore heat recovery and how it could help improve sustainability around the world, all without having to give up streaming YouTube videos. Because nobody wants that. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. The invention of computers created a new market for information and data processing. It's a cliche to say that they keep changing the world, so I won't say it. But they are. Things ramped up fast from the first practical computers in the 1950s and 60s, to IBM emerging as the computing leader in the 1970s, to Microsoft leading the software revolution in the 1990s. Since the 2000s, computing has been fed data streams like traffic data, airline trips, banking transactions, social media, YouTube says hello, stock markets, cryptocurrency mining, you get the idea. And cloud-based services have been on a steep upward trend. But all that storage and those cloud-based services come at a cost. According to a study developed by the Ernst Orlando Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory, between 2000 and 2005, there was nearly a 90% increase in data center energy usage. Between 2005 and 2010, it increased another 24%. And between 2010 and 2014, it increased by 4%. Part of the reason for decreasing percentages is from more efficient computers and storage systems, as well as hyperscaling, which is running thousands of high utilization servers in efficient spaces, and virtualization, which is running multiple processes and instances on one computer. While those percentage increases have slowed, we're still talking about 73 terawatt hours of electricity consumption for US data centers in 2020 alone. That's more energy than the entire country of Switzerland uses. Worldwide, data centers account for a couple hundred terawatt hours, or about 1% of energy consumption. In addition to using a ton of energy, these machines release a significant amount of heat that's usually wasted. Although we can see a positive worldwide movement toward renewables, carbon-heavy sources still account for a big share of electricity generation. While we need supercomputers and data centers to maintain many of the systems we've come to rely on, we also have to be conscious of the effects that they have on the environment. But there's one key aspect to focus on for all of this: heat. All of these computers produce an immense amount of heat that has to get cooled off in order to keep the computers working properly, which is where the heat that we do want comes into play. According to the 2021 Annual Energy Outlook from the EIA, space heating represented 15% of the total household electricity use here in the US just for 2020, and accounted for about 190 terawatt hours. From a macro perspective, heat is the largest energy draw and contributes 40% of global CO2 equivalent emissions and accounted for 50% of global energy consumption in 2018. It'd be great if we could channel the data center waste heat into something more useful. While companies and researchers around the globe have been developing technologies to recover computing heat in data centers, and one company in particular is focused on buildings you may work or live in, but I'll get there in a minute. First, let's take a look at everyone's favorite tech company, Facebook. I'm just kidding, but seriously, they are an interesting case study. At Odense facility in Denmark, copper coils filled with water are used to transfer heat from the data center to some heat pump facilities. The heat pumps use the server-warmed water to raise the temperature of a water loop that provides hot water to Odense's household's radiators. Facebook expects that the data center will recover 100,000 megawatt hours of electricity every year when the system is running at full throttle. It's enough to warm 6,900 homes. But depending on the cost of electricity, in some parts of the world, the use of heat pumps to boost low temperature from hot aisles and data centers, which is usually 25 to 40 degrees Celsius, might not be economically viable. Another example is the Dutch tech company Block Heating, which has worked out a containerized data center design. It uses liquid cooling to pull out heat and pipe it into commercial greenhouses to keep tomatoes and bell peppers growing during the fall and winter months without using gas. But all of these solutions run into a similar problem. Data centers need to be close to where you want to use the heat, and in some cases, they may not be economically feasible. But a French company has designed a fascinating technology for computing heat recovery where you actually need it. But before I get to that, I'd like to thank Surfshark for sponsoring today's video. I always recommend using a VPN when using public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can be very useful even when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial targeting and tracking, A VPN can protect you from that. Surfshark Clean Web does a great job blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, making it safer to use the internet, even at home. And you can even make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. This can come in handy if you want to stream a video that's only available from a specific location. And one of the best parts of Surfshark is that it's easy to set up on all of your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account to use with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code to get 83% off plus 3 extra months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. Link in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to that company. I'm about to butcher the name because of my American accent, but Carnot is putting the heat sources where they can be reused more easily, and they don't have to build out huge data center buildings and infrastructure like a typical company, something like Google, Amazon, or Apple. Instead of cramming computer servers that need cooling into massive, centralized data centers, Carnot is spreading the computing power throughout domestic or public buildings where heat can be reused. The company offers two products right now, the QH1, which is a computer heater that looks a lot like a radiator, and the QB1, which is a digital boiler system. Both are using the heat generated by microprocessors on board to radiate heat or generate hot water in a boiler. By performing complex IT operations, these high-performance computers give up heat that is directly dissipated to anything from apartment buildings to offices or even warehouses. Now, first, they sell and install these systems in a building, which are installed and wired up with high-speed internet and integrated into their distributed cloud computer system. Then, like any other computer, when its QH1 and QB1 process data and calculations for their online services that they sell, they produce heat, which is recovered to warm the room or the boiler system they've been installed in. The company's digital boiler, the QB1, heats up water by reusing the heat released by 24 servers. Water circulating in the boiler pipes captures heat and can reach temperatures over 60 degrees Celsius. Each QB1 module can provide up to 3 kilowatts of power. Now, I had a chance to talk to Quentin Lawrence, who's the head of external relations at Carnot, and he made clear that their business is based on two legs: selling computer services and reusing waste heat for the building.
One is about selling computing power to big companies, industries, research laboratories, and so on, who need high loads of computing power. And on the other hand, we sell devices that are the boiler that you mentioned, or the heater, that release heat and that embed microprocessors as heat sources. So if I can sum up what Carnot does, Carnot offers low carbon computing power by spreading computing units directly within buildings and by reusing waste heat from IT.
Building owners keep full control over the heater. The more heat that's needed, the more the processors perform IT computations. And according to Lawrence, the boiler has the advantage of their two products.
The boiler is a good product because it works all year long, producing hot water for like sanitary needs, hot sanitary water, or for heat networks in places where heat networks are installed.
Regarding costs, customers need to make an initial investment for the hardware, but after that, they'll have no functioning costs.
What we do is that we sell the machine, and then we reimburse all the electricity bills. We do the maintenance for free, and we replace the machines regularly to have quite high performances in terms of computing.
All of this presents some interesting advantages, like not having to build out large, expensive data centers. Carnot's distributed data center approach also gives them a bit of an edge for rolling out new capacity too.
We don't need any more dedicated buildings, so no data center construction, no refreshment because we dissipate heat, and we have a single source of energy doing both activities. One is to provide computing power, and second thing is to provide heat. So we have a system in which the reduction of CO2 emissions is around 85%.
But how powerful can a distributed system like this actually be? Well, you've probably seen their work.
And to give you examples, we are also very flexible in terms of deployment. We've been working with Universal Pictures for the Minions movie you probably know about, which will be in the cinemas next year because of the COVID. The clients on the computing side are big banks doing Monte Carlo simulations, 3D studios doing 3D renderings with us, laboratory research who are needing computing power for big data, machine learning in lots of sectors, computational fluid dynamics for aeronautics, for trains, for any CFD computations that you need.
One challenge with a computer as a heat source concept is that the product really only makes sense in colder climates or regions. Like me being in the New England region of the US. From late spring to early fall, I wouldn't be using a computer heater device at all to heat my home, which means the company wouldn't be able to use it as part of the distributed system. On that count, Quentin expressed that's why Corneau is focused more on their boiler strategy.
The boiler has two advantages. The first one is to embed 24 microprocessors, which is quite a big computing power. And second thing is that it is used within buildings and it is installed to function all day long and all year long also, which is not the case of the heater for countries like France, where you have winters and summers that are very different in terms of temperatures.
So for the heat generation side of their products, they're looking more at northern markets right now.
We have, I would say, three zones in the world. North America, so USA and Canada, but we are not very active there yet. And a bit more active in Europe with Germany and the Nordics, so Sweden, Norway, Denmark, and Finland, where there are huge heat needs.
And even though climate does play a role in what regions this type of system can be used, there's still a very large potential market. All of Corneau's IT clients, the 3D studios or big banks that are buying computational power, can be located anywhere in the world. There's no limitation on that side of the business. This is a very clever and innovative solution that they've cooked up, but it's not a magical solution that will work for all situations. In addition to being somewhat limited to colder climates for their server locations, you're also limited on internet availability. You need to be in locations with access to high-speed networks like fiber optics. Without that, a distributed server network would run into serious issues. And there are many types of computational use cases that may not fit with what Corneau can provide. I don't think Netflix is going to be using something like this to host millions of concurrent video streams, but it's a great fit for rendering animations for a major film production. It's all about the right tool for the right job. Now, while waste heat recovery in large data centers may be ramping up at a slower pace, innovative approaches to waste heat recovery like what Corneau is doing really does warm my heart. It's out-of-the-box thinking like this that can not only help the environment, but also our never-ending thirst for streaming the next YouTube video. So what do you think? Do you think there's more potential for heat recovery systems like this? And what other industries could contribute? Jump in the comments and let me know. Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. And as always, thanks to all my patrons whose support makes these videos possible. If you join, you'll get early access to ad-free versions of all the videos on Patreon, and I hold monthly Zoom calls for higher-level supporters and producers. Check out the link in the description for more details. If you like this video, check out one of the ones I have linked to right here, I think it's on this side. And of course, thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.